Part 7. Barriers to Entry and Fixed Costs of Living. How Intellectual Property Impedes Competition. Kevin A. Carson, 2009. Any consideration of intellectual property rights must start from the understanding that such rights undermine genuine property rights and hence are illegitimate in terms of libertarian principle. Real tangible property rights result from natural scarcity and follow as a matter of course from the attempt to maintain occupancy of physical property that cannot be possessed by more than one person at a time. Intellectual property, on the other hand, creates artificial scarcity where it does not naturally exist and can only be enforced by invading real tangible property and preventing the owner from using it in ways that violate the supposed intellectual property rights of others. As Stefan Kinsella points out, had a particularly gifted Cro-Magnon man been able to patent the building of log cabins, his heirs today would be entitled to prevent us from building cabins on our own land with our own logs until we paid whatever tribute they demanded. The business model required by proprietary digital information is even more invasive of genuine property rights than was traditional copyright law. The digital copyright regime in force under the terms of the Digital Millennium Copyright Act, the WIPO Copyright Treaty, and the TRIPS provision of the Uruguay Round of GATT is focused entirely on preventing one from using his own hard drive and other property as he sees fit. It is actually illegal, thanks to such legislation, to sell hardware capable of circumventing DRM or to publicize the codes enabling someone to circumvent it. As Cory Doctorow points out, it's funny that in the name of protecting intellectual property, big media companies are willing to do such violence to the idea of real property, arguing that since everything we own, from our t-shirts to our cars to our e-books, embodies someone's copyright, patent, and trademark, that we're basically just tenant farmers living on the land of our gracious masters who've seen fit to give us a lease on our homes. DRM prevents the easy transfer of content between platforms, even when it's simply a matter of the person who purchased a CD or DVD wanting to play it somewhere more convenient. And the DMCA legally prohibits circumventing such DRM, even when, again, the purchaser of the content simply wants to facilitate his own use on a wider and more convenient variety of platforms. The levels of invasiveness required by intellectual property in the digital age cannot be exaggerated. The intrusive DRM embedded in proprietary media and the draconian legislation criminalizing technical means of circumvention should make that clear. The logical tendency of the digital copyright regime was portrayed quite convincingly by Richard Stallman in a dystopian short story, The Right to Read. Just Google it, it's well worth your time. Corporations rely on increasingly authoritarian legislation to capture value from proprietary information. Johann Soderberg compares the way photocopiers were monitored in the old USSR to protect the power of elites in that country from the free flow of information to the way the means of digital reproduction are monitored in this country to protect corporate power. Privileged, state-connected economic interests are becoming increasingly dependent on such controls, but unfortunately for them, such controls are becoming increasingly unenforceable thanks to BitTorrent, strong encryption, and proxy servers. The DCSS uprising, in which court injunctions against a code to hack DVD encryption met with the defiant publishing of the code on blogs, mirror sites, and even t-shirts, is a case in point. The unenforceability of intellectual property rights undermines the business model prevalent among a major share of privileged, state-connected firms. Obsolete business model. In the old days, the immense value of physical assets was the primary structural support for corporate boundaries, and in particular for the control of corporate hierarchies over human capital and other intangible assets. The declining importance of physical assets relative to human capital has changed this. As human capital becomes the primary source of corporate equity, the old rationale for corporate institutional control is evaporating. In the information and entertainment industries, before the digital and internet revolutions, the initial outlay for entering the market was in the hundreds of thousands of dollars or more. The old electronic mass media, as Yochai Benkler put it, were typified by high-cost hubs and cheap, ubiquitous reception-only systems at the end. This led to a limited range of organizational models for production, those that could collect sufficient funds to set up a hub. The same was true of print periodicals, with the increasing cost of printing equipment from the mid-19th century on serving as the main entry barrier for organizing the hubs. Between 1835 and 1850, the typical startup cost of a newspaper increased from $500 to $100,000, or from roughly $10,000 to $2.38 million in 2005 dollars. The networked economy, in contrast, is distinguished by network architecture and the low cost of becoming a speaker. The central change that makes this possible is that the basic physical capital necessary to express and communicate human meaning is the connected personal computer. The desktop revolution and the internet mean that the minimum capital outlay for entering most of the entertainment and information industry has fallen to a few thousand dollars, and the marginal cost of reproduction is zero. The networked environment, combined with endless varieties of cheap software for creating and editing content, makes it possible for the amateur to produce output of a quality once associated with giant publishing houses and recording companies. That is true of the software industry, the music industry, thanks to cheap equipment and software for high-quality recording and sound editing, desktop publishing, and to a certain extent even to film, as witnessed by affordable editing technology and the success of Sky Captain. Podcasting technology makes it possible to distribute radio and television programming at virtually no cost to anyone with a broadband connection. A network of amateur contributors have peer-produced an encyclopedia, Wikipedia, which Britannica sees as a rival. As Tom Coates put it, the gap between what can be accomplished at home and what can be accomplished in a work environment has narrowed dramatically over the last 10 to 15 years. It's also true of news, with ever-expanding networks of amateurs and venues like indie media, alternative new operations like Robert Perry's and Greg Palast's, and natives and American troops blogging news firsthand from Iraq, at the very same time the traditional broadcasting networks are shutting down. Agency problems, breakaway firms. This has profoundly weakened corporate hierarchies in the information and entertainment industries and created enormous agency problems as well. As human capital eclipses physical capital as the main source of corporate equity, it becomes increasingly feasible for the human capital assets to vote with their feet and take their skills elsewhere, forming breakaway firms and leaving their former employers as hollowed-out firms that own little more than the company name. Maurice Saatchi's walkout from the Saatchi & Saatchi Advertising Agency and the walkout of Solomon Brothers Traders, responsible for 87% of the bond trading firm's profits, are two good examples. As organization theory writer Luigi Zingales put it, "If we take the standpoint that the boundary of the firm is the point up to which top management has the ability to exercise power, the group was not an integral part of Salomon. It merely rented space, Salomon's name, and capital, and turned over some share of its profits as rent." David Prochico remarked on breakaway firms in the tech industry back in the 1990s when it was barely underway. "Old firms act as embryos for new firms. If a worker or group of workers is not satisfied with the existing firm, each has a skill which he or she controls and can leave the firm with those skills and establish a new one. In the information age, it is becoming more evident that a boss cannot control the workers as one did in the days when the assembly line was dominant. People cannot be treated as workhorses any longer, for the value of the production process is becoming increasingly embodied in the intellectual skills of the worker. This poses a new threat to the traditional firm if it denies participatory organization." The appearance of breakaway computer firms leads one to question the extent to which our existing system of property rights and ideas and information actually protects bosses in other industries against the countervailing power of workers. Perhaps our current system of patents, copyrights, and other intellectual property rights not only impedes competition and fosters monopoly, as some Austrians argue. Intellectual property rights may also reduce the likelihood of breakaway firms in general and discourage the shift to more participatory cooperative formats. In this environment, the only thing standing between the old information and media dinosaurs and their total collapse is their so-called intellectual property rights, at least to the extent that they're still enforceable. Ownership of intellectual property becomes the new basis for the power of institutional hierarchies and the primary buttress for corporate boundaries. The increasing prevalence and imploding cost of small-scale distributed production machinery and the rise of crowdsourced distributed means of aggregating capital from small donors means that physical production is governed by the same phenomenon to a considerable extent. Without intellectual property, in any industry where the basic production equipment is widely affordable and bottom-up networking renders management obsolete, it is likely that self-managed cooperative production will replace the old managerial hierarchies. The network revolution, if its full potential is realized, as James Bennett put it in the appropriately titled article, "The End of Capitalism and the Triumph of the Market Economy," will lead to substantial redistribution of power and money from the 20th century industrial producers of information, culture, and communications, like Hollywood, the recording industry, and perhaps the broadcasters and some of the telecommunications giants, to a combination of widely diffuse populations around the globe and the market actors that will build the tools that make this population better able to produce its own information environment rather than buying it ready-made. Paying for the name. Another effect of the shift in importance from tangible to intangible assets is that a growing portion of product prices consists of embedded rents on intellectual property and other artificial property rights rather than the material costs of production. Tom Peters, in the Tom Peters seminar, was fond of gushing about the increasing portion of product value made up of ephemera and intellect, i.e. the amount of final price consisting of tribute to the owners of intellectual property, rather than labor and material costs. To quote Michael Perlman, "The so-called weightless economy has more to do with the legislated powers of intellectual property that the government granted to powerful corporations. For example, companies such as Nike, Microsoft, and Pfizer sell stuff that has high value relative to its weight only because their intellectual property rights insulate them from competition." But intellectual property, as we have already seen, is becoming increasingly unenforceable. As a result, the ownership of proprietary content is becoming increasingly untenable as a basis for corporate institutional power, and we can expect the portion of commodity price resulting from embedded rents on artificial property rights to implode. Intellectual property also serves as a bulwark for planned obsolescence and high overhead production. A major component of the business model that prevails under existing corporate capitalism is the offer of platforms below cost coupled with the sale of patented or copyrighted spare parts, accessories, etc. at an enormous markup. So one buys a cell phone for little or nothing with the contractual obligation to use only a specified service package for so many years. One buys a fairly cheap printer which uses enormously expensive ink cartridges. One buys a cheap glucometer with glucose testing strips that cost $100 a box. And to hack one's phone to use a different service plan or to manufacture generic ink cartridges or glucose testing strips in competition with the proprietary version is illegal. As it is now, appliances are generally designed to thwart repair. When the repairman tells you it would cost more than it's worth to repair your washing machine, he's telling the truth. But that state of affairs reflects a deliberate design. The machine could have been designed on a modular basis so that the defective part might have been cheaply and easily replaced. And if the manufacturer were subject to unfettered competition, the normal market incentive would be to do so. Absent legal constraints, it would be profitable to offer competing generic replacements and accessories for other firms' platforms. And in the face of such competition, there would be strong pressure toward modular product designs that were amenable to repair and interoperable with the modular components and accessories of other companies' platforms. Absent the legal constraints of patents, an appliance designed to thwart ease of repair through incompatibility with other companies' platforms would suffer a competitive disadvantage. Patents historically promoted the stable control of markets by oligopoly firms through the control, exchange, and pooling of patents. According to David Noble, two essentially new science-based industries, those that grew out of the soil of scientific rather than traditional craft knowledge, emerged in the late 19th century, the electrical and chemical industries. In the electric industry, General Electric had its origins first in a merger between Edison Electric, which controlled all of Edison's electrical patents, and the Sprague Electric Railway and Motor Company, and then in an 1892 merger between Edison General Electric and Thomas Houston, both of them motivated primarily by patent considerations. From the 1890s on, the electrical industry was dominated by two large firms, GE and Westinghouse, both of which owed their market shares largely to patent control. By 1896, the litigation cost from some 300 pending patent suits was enormous, and the two companies agreed to form a joint board of patent control. General Electric and Westinghouse pooled their patents, with GE handling 62.5% of the combined business. The structure of the telephone industry had similar origins, with the Bell Patent Association forming the nucleus of the first Bell Industrial Organization and eventually of AT&T. The National Bell Telephone Company from the 1880s on fought vigorously to occupy the field, in the words of General Manager Theodore N. Vail, through patent control. AT&T, anticipating the expiration of its original patents, had surrounded the business with all the auxiliary protection that was possible. By the time the FCC was formed in 1935, the Bell system had acquired patents to some of the most important inventions in telephony and radio, and, through various radio patent pool agreements in the 1920s, had effectively consolidated its position relative to the other giants in the industry. The American chemical industry, in its modern form, was made possible by the Justice Department's seizure of German chemical patents in World War I. More generally, intellectual property is an effective tool for cartelizing markets in industry at large. They were used in the automobile and steel industries, among others, according to Noble. In a 1906 article, mechanical engineer and patent lawyer Edwin Prindle described patents as the best and most effective means of controlling competition. And unlike purely private cartels, which tend toward defection and instability, patent control cartels, being based on a state-granted privilege, carry a credible and effective punishment for defection. At the global level, intellectual property plays the same protectionist role for transnational corporations that tariffs performed in the old national economies. It's hardly coincidental that the dominant industrial sectors in the global corporate economy are all heavily dependent on intellectual property: software, entertainment, biotech, pharmaceuticals, and electronics. And the central focus of the neoliberal system, which has been falsely identified with free trade and free markets, is on strengthening the legal intellectual property regime as the primary source of profits. Trademarks and other forms of intellectual property are central to what Naomi Klein calls the Nike model, by which TNCs outsource actual production to independently owned job shops while retaining control of finance, marketing, and IP. Absent strong IP law, independent job shops could treat corporate headquarters and produce knockoffs of identical quality without the enormous brand name markup. Patents are also used on a global scale to lock transnational manufacturing corporations into a permanent monopoly on productive technology. The central motivation in the GATT intellectual property regime is to permanently lock in the collective monopoly of advanced production technology by transnational corporations and relegate third world countries to supplying raw materials and sweatshop labor. It would, as the Third World Network's Martin Kor Kok Peng writes, effectively prevent the diffusion of technology to the third world. Intellectual property is central to the so-called cognitive capitalism model. Under that model, corporations rely on increasingly authoritarian government legislation to capture value from proprietary information. Johann Soderberg compares the way photocopiers were monitored in the old USSR to protect the power of elites in that country to the way the means of digital reproduction are monitored in this country to protect corporate power. Today, intellectual property serves as a structural support for corporate boundaries at a time when the imploding cost of production technology has undermined control of physical capital as their primary justification. In this environment, the only thing standing between the old information and media dinosaurs and their total collapse is their so-called intellectual property rights, at least to the extent they're still enforceable. Ownership of intellectual property becomes the new basis for the power of institutional hierarchies and the primary structural bulwark for corporate boundaries. Drawing to a close. But to repeat, the good news is that both in the domestic and global economies, this business model is doomed. The shift from physical to human capital as the primary source of productive capacity in so many industries, along with the imploding price and widespread dispersion of ownership of capital equipment, means that corporate employers are increasingly hollowed out and only maintain control over the physical production process through legal fictions. When so much of actual physical production is outsourced to the independent small shop, whether it be a Chinese sweatshop, a flexible manufacturing firm in Emilia-Romagna, or a member of GM's supplier network, the corporation becomes a redundant node that can be bypassed. As blogger David Pollard described it, from the perspective of a future historian in 2015, the expensive outsourcers quickly found themselves unnecessary middlemen, the large corporations having shed everything they thought was non-core competency, learned to their chagrin that in the connected information economy, the value of their core competency was much less than the inflated value of their stock, and they have lost much of their market share to new federations of small entrepreneurial businesses. For all the harm it does, intellectual property is not really even necessary as an incentive for innovation. Industrial analyst F.M. Scherer argued that in the 1990s, based on a survey of 91 companies, that some 86% of all process and product innovations would have been developed from the necessity of remaining competitive, the desire for efficient production, and the desire to expand and diversify their sales. And copyright is no more necessary for artistic creation than patents are necessary for invention. There are many businesses, in the open source world, that manage to make money from auxiliary services even though their content itself is not proprietary. For example, Red Hat makes money off open source Linux software by customizing the software and offering specialized customer support. Fish has actively encouraged fans to share its music free of charge while making money off of live performances and concessions. Since IP is not necessary to encourage innovation, this means its main practical effect is to cause economic inefficiency by levying a monopoly charge on the use of existing technology. In any case, whether or not intellectual property is necessary to profit from certain forms of economic activity should be beside the point for principled libertarians. That's the same argument used by protectionists. Certain businesses would be unprofitable if they weren't protected by tariffs. But no one has a right to profit at someone else's expense through the use of force. In particular, no one has the right to make a profit by using the state to prevent others from doing as they please with their own pen and paper, hard drives, or CDs. A business model that isn't profitable without government intervention should fail.